In this final portion of the course, where we've been focusing on Markov chains, there are three basic concepts we've looked at. One is the idea of taking the transition matrix and raising it to a power to get multi-step transition probabilities. The second has been the idea of a regular Markov chain where you look for long-term steady-state probability distributions. And the third has been absorbing Markov chains where you have certain absorbing states and you're interested in the probability of entering in the long run any of the possible absorbing states. In this final video, we're going to take a couple examples and tie these ideas together. That is, look at multiple ideas in the context of the same example. So we start with a company with stores in Boston and Chicago that's targeting sales to men, women, and children. And when items sit for a while without selling, they shuffle them around between the stores. And we have data on how that shuffling occurs. Certain items shipped from the Boston store to the Chicago store and vice versa. And we have data on sales data on each of the store indicating which of the population groups, men, women, and children, they're selling to. So we want to begin by massaging all that information a bit, and of course we need to put it into either a transition diagram or a transition matrix to get started. Let's go directly to the matrix. Any item in the store is eventually going to be sold to either a man, a woman, or a child, or else the item will still be in one of the two stores, the Boston store or the Chicago store. So we have five states. We have items sold to men, sold to women, sold to children, or still found, the item still being found in the Boston store, or still being found in the Chicago store. The transition probabilities for all of these come from the data we were just looking at. Once an item is sold to a man, woman, or child, it's gone, it's out of the picture, so we treat those three states as absorbing states. We're no longer interested in the item after it's been sold. So men, women, and children, sales represent absorbing states. The transition probabilities for the Boston and Chicago store are based on what happens to items in a week's time. In the Boston store, 10% of the stock is sold to men, 10% is sold to women, 20% is sold to children, 40% remains in the Boston store unsold, and 20% of the items are shipped to the Chicago store. And similarly, the bottom row gives information on what happens to items located in the Chicago store. Now, one kind of question you could look at is, what's the probability that an item in the Boston store will be sold within 3 weeks? Here we're talking about a specified time period, three weeks, which in the context of this Markov chain represents three steps. So we can get that kind of information by simply looking at the third power of the transition matrix. If we calculate the transition matrix to the third power, this is what we get. So that's just matrix arithmetic to do that computation. We look in these lower spots and we see that for something that starts out in the Boston store, after 3 weeks, there's about a 19% chance it will have been sold to a man, about a 22.5% chance to a woman, and almost a 42% chance it will have been sold to a child. The item may still be unsold, and here are the probabilities of it remaining unsold and being in each of the two stores. So the main point is that the information we're looking for is obtained by simply looking at the third power of the transition matrix, because we're specifically asking the question, what's the probability the item will be sold within 3 weeks? So we're looking at a fixed 3-week time period. The probability that the item in the Boston store is sold within 3 weeks, we can get by simply adding up these three probabilities, because we know the probability it's sold to a man, we know the probability it's sold to a woman, and we know the probability it's sold to a child. So if we simply add up those numbers, we have the probability that it's been sold within the 3 week period. Now, if we're interested in the long-term probabilities, that is, in the long term, will the item be sold to a man, woman, or child, we need to view the transition matrix as an absorbing transition matrix. So we need to use what we learned in part 6.4 to get the long-term probabilities for the two absorbing states. So this is when we split the transition matrix up into the four parts, as we do with absorbing Markov chain models. In this instance, the upper left corner is 3x3 identity because we're dealing with three absorbing states in this example. And the matrix R is 2x3, two rows and three columns, and Q is 2x2. So when we start carrying out the recipe for absorbing Markov chains in this example, I minus Q is 2x2. We have to find the inverse of it, which turns out to be what's shown at the bottom here. And then we do the matrix multiplication, that inverse times the bottom left-hand corner. So in this instance, we're multiplying a 2x2 N times a 2x3 R, which means we get a 2x3 product. And as usual, we label the rows with the non-absorbing states and the columns with the absorbing states. And the numbers give us those long-term probabilities for entering the various absorbing states. Let's interpret the data. If an item is in the Boston store, then in the long run, there's a 22.5% chance it'll be sold to a man, a 27.5% chance it'll be sold to a woman, and a 50% chance it'll be sold to a child. And here are the corresponding probabilities for an item in the Chicago store. The answer to this specific question, the probability that an item in the Boston store will eventually be sold to a woman, we go from Boston store to woman, and we see the probability 0.275. Now, on average, how long will an item in the Chicago store be held in one of the stores before being sold? This is where we need to go back to the matrix N. N was 2x2 in this case. We label the rows and the columns with the non-absorbing states. How long will an item in the Chicago store be held in one of the stores before being sold? Well, on average in the Chicago store, an item will spend 1/4 of a week in the Boston store before being sold, and 1.5 weeks in the Chicago store before being sold. We add those two numbers, and we get 1 3/4 weeks as the average length of time an item will remain in inventory prior to being sold in one of the two stores. Now let's go back and revisit the idea of an initial probability distribution. Suppose the company starts out with half their items in Boston and half in Chicago. How will these original items be distributed 3 weeks later? This is the kind of situation where we need the transition probability, of course, and what we're looking at here, since we're talking about a 3 weeks time frame, what we actually need is the third power of the transition matrix. So we need the third power of the transition matrix, and we need the original probability distribution. In this case, our initial probability distribution is taken as 0.5, 0.5. We're starting out with a collection of items which none of them are sold to start with, so zeros for sales to men, women, and children. Our original collection of items, 50% are located in the Boston store and 50% in the Chicago store. We want to know what's happened to those items during the 3 weeks. We multiply that initial probability distribution times the third power of the transition matrix, and we get this string of numbers, which says that after 3 weeks have passed, 17.5% of the items have been sold to men, 26.3% to women, and 43.8% to children. and 6.25% of the items remain in the Boston store, and 6.25% of the items remain in the Chicago store. So this is the complete information on what's happened to the item, to the collection of items initially equally distributed between the two stores during the 3-week period. Be aware that the idea of absorbing states is incompatible with the concept of a transition matrix being regular. The reason is that if you have an absorbing state, then you're stuck in that state forever. And remember, with regular Markov chains, the primary idea of regularity is that for some number of steps, it's possible to go from anywhere to anywhere, from any state to any other state. If you've got an absorbing state, you can't ever get out of that absorbing state. So it should be obvious to you that if you have an absorbing state, then you can't possibly be looking at a regular Markov chain. So these are very different kinds of situations. So let's think a little more deeply about regular Markov chains by going back to the Frisbee example. Three people tossing a Frisbee around. Bob always throws to Alice. Alice always throws to Carol. Carol throws sometimes to Bob and sometimes to Alice. If you think about the transition diagram for that, it has this basic pattern to it. Bob always throws it to Alice. So the only arrow going from B goes to A. Alice always throws to Carol, so the only arrow going from A goes to C. Carol sometimes throws it to Bob and sometimes throws it to Alice. I'm not going to put the probabilities into the picture because I'm not really interested in them at this point. I just want to think about the possibilities for where the Frisbee might be, depending on how many times it's been thrown. Notice that Bob doesn't throw the Frisbee to himself. There is no arrow going from B to B. The transition probability going from Bob to Bob is zero. So clearly, in the initial transition matrix, there are going to be quite a few zeros, aren't there? Can the Frisbee go from Bob to Alice in two throws? It can't, can it? Because if Bob has it, the first throw sends it to Alice, and then the next throw sends it on to Carol. So it can't possibly go from Bob to Alice in two tosses. This two-step transition probability is zero, which says that the transition matrix squared, one of those two-step transition probabilities is going to be zero. So T squared will have at least one zero in it based on what we are observing right here. Notice that it can't go from Bob to Carol in three tosses. Why is that? If Bob has it, the first toss has to take it to Alice, the next toss has to take it to Carol, and then no matter who Carol throws it to, it'll be either with Bob or Alice. It won't be with Carol. So if you start with Bob, after it's thrown three times, it can't possibly be in Carol's hands. So that three-step probability has to be zero. You can't go from Bob to Carol in three tosses. So this is at least one zero, which will appear in T cubed, the third power of the transition matrix. Observe that it can't go from Bob to Bob in four tosses. Why is that? Well, Bob has it. First toss sends it to Alice. Second toss sends it to Carol. Third toss has to send it to either Bob or Alice. If it goes to Bob, then the fourth toss takes it back to Alice. If it goes to Alice, the fourth toss takes it back to Carol. So no matter what happens, after four tosses, it's not back to Bob. There is no way, if Bob has it, that it can be tossed four times and be back in Bob's hands. So this four-step transition probability is zero, which says that the transition matrix raised to the fourth power will have at least one zero in it, namely the one that we're looking at right here. Now finally, it's possible to check that in 5 throws of the Frisbee, it can go from anybody to anybody. And I'm not going to go through all of those scenarios, but let's take one or two of them and just see if we can convince ourselves it's true. How can it get from, let's say, Bob to Bob in 5 tosses? Well, it could go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That would get you from Bob to Bob in 5 tosses. How can you get from Alice to Bob in 5 tosses? Well, you could go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and that gets you from Alice to Bob in 5 tosses. So test yourself on this a little bit. Pick 2 arbitrary states up here and see if you can track how it could get from one to the other in five tosses. So the bottom line is, we're saying that all the 5-step transition probabilities are non-zero. It is possible to go from any state to any other state in 5 steps. So the 5th power of the transition matrix will not have any zeros. And then you could confirm that by going back to the transition matrix, actually taking it to the 5th power and looking at it and seeing that you don't have any zeros there. Now, if you actually do the arithmetic, you compute the transition matrix cubed, you find that there are zeros in these 2 spots. You go up to the 4th power, there's the 0 in this spot, which corresponded to our observation that if Bob has it to start with, it's impossible for him to have it again after it's been thrown 4 times. But finally, when you go to the 5th power, you're rid of all the zeros. So that demonstrates that this situation is a regular Markov chain, and therefore everything we learned about regular transition matrices is applicable in this problem. So you can legitimately compute the long-term probabilities of being in each of the 3 states after a large number of tosses, steady-state probability distribution. Remember, when you're talking about steady-state probability distributions, that's applicable only in the context of a regular Markov chain.